The bookstore does close at 8 p.m., so they'll be shutting down the register and cleaning up over there. Again, thanks everybody for coming. We appreciate you registering ahead of time. That helps us plan how to lay out the room and everything, so that we can do it in the most comfortable fashion. And thank you so much for supporting us over the past couple of years. Without you here, we cannot be here. And without a brick and mortar store, we can't have a flesh and blood author. So thank you very, very, very much for supporting us and for being here for this event. We're so thrilled to be able to host this incredible story of Kentucky history and an incredible story of uplifting women and people and healthcare and all of these tremendously wonderful themes. Without further ado, Jyoti Thottam is a senior opinion editor at the New York Times. You might have heard of it. prior to joining the Times, she was a reporter, editor, and foreign correspondent. From 2008 to 2012, she was the Times South Asia Bureau Chief in New Delhi, where she wrote numerous cover stories, including award-winning stories about the Ganges River and the Mumbai terrorist attacks. Born in India, she grew up in Texas and graduated from Yale and Columbia. She lives with her family in Brooklyn. Everybody, the family in Kentucky warmly welcomes you here. Thank you so much.
At least a couple of members of the Sisters of Charity of Nazareth here, and a couple of members of the family of one of the sisters in the story, which is a great honor for me that you all came today. And I think it's, you know, really like this book was a product of many years of work on my part, but it really couldn't have been possible without the help of the families of the sisters, and also the order here, who were just so generous with their time and with their research and their archives. So thank you to all of you. So what I wanted to do to start, because I know some of you may have read the book, but others may not have yet, I wanted to start with a short reading from the introduction of the book that I hope will give you an idea of how I sort of got started with writing this book and like what prompted me to try to understand this story a little more thoroughly. So just to set the scene, one of the first interviews I did was with Sister Ann Roberta Powers, who was the youngest of the group of six sisters from Kentucky who went on this journey to India. And I was lucky enough that when I started my research, Sister Ann Roberta was still alive. She's passed away since then. So I had the chance to interview her in person, and she was really one of the first interviews I did. Diane Curtis, who's here with me, helped arrange that interview. I was living in India at the time, and Sister Ann Roberta was retired, and she was also living in India at the time. So I went to visit her. She was just a wonderful person. She grew up in Cloverport, Kentucky, a small town here near on the Ohio River. Some of you all may know it. And, you know, I sat down and talked to her for a couple of hours, and it was just an amazing experience because this was, I think, in 2011, maybe. But she was recalling the events of 1947, like, as if they had happened just days earlier. She was one of those people who could remember things and tell you a story in that way. So, you know, I started to ask her about her early life in Cloverport, you know, her decision to enter the convent, the journey to India, all of that. So I'll just start, so there I've set the scene for you, and I'll just sort of start there with some of what she told me. Okay. Ann Roberta was only 22 when she left America in 1947. She had not even taken her final vows, the last step in making a lifetime commitment to religious life. And the two-month journey from Kentucky to India by ship and cross-country train was the adventure of a lifetime. She She recited the dates and details as if she had stepped off the ship only days earlier. She told me about the first months of setting up the hospital, scrounging for supplies, improvising beds and bandages, planting a garden, and learning to bargain for vegetables in Hindi with merchants in the bazaar. I asked her what kind of patients they would get in those early days, and she immediately recalled the orphans. This was in the first years after the traumatic partition that split the subcontinent into India and Pakistan. 12 million people left their homes, fleeing violence or taking a chance on a new life on the other side of the newly drawn borders, and families were scattered in every direction. She told me about one little girl who was brought to the hospital from the train station at Mokama by the railway police. She was still a toddler, well-fed and beautiful. That in itself was unusual. Most of the orphans who landed at Nazareth Hospital arrived malnourished and sick. But this girl had been traveling with her mother on a train from Delhi to Calcutta. About halfway through the journey, as the train halted at a station in the middle of the night, the mother told the other people in the compartment that she wanted to get some more milk for her child. Would they mind keeping an eye on her while she slept? The mother never came back. The other passengers thought she must have boarded in a different car and would walk back to her berth. But when the train reached the next station, Mokama, she still had not returned. They called the railway police, who brought the abandoned child to the convent. The nuns carried her inside to examine her. She was lethargic, perhaps drugged, but otherwise healthy. She wore a diaper, a soft, store-bought one, a luxury at the time. The nuns began to undress her to put her to bed, and discovered that she was wearing 6 frilly dresses, one on top of the other. They must have been all the clothing she owned in the world. Anne Roberta paused for a moment over that detail, stunning in its tenderness and cruelty. It was St. Barnard's Day, so they called her Marie Bernadette. That was the moment I felt that there was more to the story of Nazareth Hospital than I had imagined. It was built out of the ashes of partition, a place where those who had escaped or endured the ruptures of home and community would learn to look at this new and brutal world for what it was. When you could no longer count on anyone to protect you, where would you go? What would you do? Who would you be? What kind of place was India in 1947? Where a woman might lovingly prepare her own child to be abandoned. There were thousands of such children in India at the time, orphans whose parents had been killed in the months of violence, and others who were left behind in the great rush of people fleeing from one place to another. This girl didn't look like a refugee. She could have been the child of a marriage between a Hindu and a Muslim. During partition, the lines between communities parted. Parents and children, husbands and wives were sometimes forced to choose between one country and the other. She could have been the product of rape. There were thousands of women on both sides of the border who suffered sexual violence, and it took many months for the governments of India and Pakistan to decide the fate of their children. There were also thousands of husbands who went off to fight or to find their fortunes on the other side of the partition line. And it was not uncommon for months to pass without their sending word back to their wives. Had the child's mother been one of those wives who took a lover to fill the silence? Or perhaps she had simply decided to seize that moment when the whole world was in chaos to choose a different life for herself. Another city, another name, another destiny, one that she would choose for herself. In many ways, all the women of Nazareth, the sisters like Anne Roberta, who left their homes in Kentucky to go to India, and the young women like my mother, who left their villages to study nursing, were animated by the same impulse. The years after World War II in the United States, and the years after partition in India,
were in one important way the same. They were years of tumult and trauma when those whose lives had been constrained by an old order found themselves suddenly free when that order was destroyed. Pain and loss were everywhere for the women of that time. But what looked like a vacuum was, for some women, an opening, a chance to create for themselves lives that would never have been possible otherwise. So I thought I'd stop there. I know many of you have not had a chance to read the book, but if you have or just have questions about the book, the process, the story, I would love to hear them.
What led you to start this journey?
Mm-hmm. So you could say it was a question that I had had in the back of my mind since I was a child. You know, like many people, especially, you know, if your family comes from somewhere else, you sort of ask your parents these questions, right? Like, why did we come to the United States? Like, how did that all happen? Like, how did you all get from there to here? And so, you know, my mother would tell me these vague stories about, well, you know, I went to study nursing in this school. It was far away from my home. And it was run by these nuns from Kentucky. And, oh, they were very strict, but I learned a lot, and now we're here. And that was sort of, she kind of skipped over many parts of the story, as I think, you know, like we all do, telling stories to our children about our early lives. So, you know, as a child, you just think that your family story, it just is what it is. You don't think of it as anything really special. But when I became a journalist, and particularly when I was working as a correspondent in India, and I actually had a chance to visit Bihar, the place where that nursing school was and still is, it is really one of the most difficult parts of India. I mean, it's a place that many people, even Indians, would hesitate to go to because it just has this reputation. So when I saw it, that's when I really started to understand, wow, this was not just any nursing school in any place. Like, she went to one of the, you know, a very difficult place, and how did those women from Kentucky, how did they get there? Like, you know, the pieces were just not quite fitting together for me. So so basically, just as a journalist, there were so many questions that I wanted to answer for myself. And, you know, there's only so much my mother could tell me. So then I really started this process of researching, gathering string, as they say in journalism. And again, that interview with Anne Roberta was one of the early ones that I did. And talking to her and getting a sense of how much there was that I had no idea about in that story, I thought, like, this might actually be a book. I should really sort of look into this further. So that was where it began.
It was a fascinating story. Your book is really good. The journey that they took, my aunt and I corresponded the whole time she was there. Mm-hmm. So it was amazing what they did. Talking about the horror of the way that people lived and how wonderful the people were, and everybody having dysentery all the time. It was an amazing time. I don't know how they did it.
Yeah.
Strong women.
They really were.
Who knows for you girls?
often sort of reluctant to speak publicly about everything they had accomplished, having taken that vow of modesty. So I was very happy to do that on their behalf.
I've graduated from Presentation Academy, which is a sister of charity school. And I've always been amazed at the sisters. They have always been stronger than most women of their time. Nobody's fool. And their care of orphans and trying to get medical care, but mainly educating women in places where that wasn't the most popular thing to do. Putting it on a very thin string budget because the sisters never got much of anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think you have to admire them so much.
Mm-hmm.
And a friend of mine went to India some years ago, and she said the kindness of the people and the wonderfulness of the people, but the horror of many of the living situations just broke your heart.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't seem to get much better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think many of the problems that were present in some form at independence, they're still there, really. It's they have very deep historical roots. But you know, you mentioned education, and I think that's something that, you know, when you imagine a hospital, of course, it's amazing what modern medicine can do, what women with nursing and medical skills can do. But in some ways, you know, one of the most lasting impacts of their work is really having educated and trained, that's right, so many hundreds of women. And just, you know, like, nursing is one of those professions that I think has opened doors for so many women around the world, really. My mother's just one, but I know there are so many families whose lives are just have taken a completely different path because someone in their family is able to go to nursing school.
Was your mother a major part of your process?
Well, you know, it's funny that you ask. I mean, of course she was there throughout the process. I interviewed her, you know, and I sort of, it was funny if you're a journalist to sit down and say, okay, now mom, like, now we're gonna sit down and I'm doing an interview and I'm recording this, so, you know, which is not how you usually talk to your mother. So I did that a couple of times, and it was, of course, wonderful, and I learned a lot, but, you know, one of the things that I reflected on a lot in this process is that, you know, that alone, like, memories are always partial. Like, she remembers what she saw, and, you know, she was so young, she was a teenager when she went there, so she viewed the teachers, you know, the sisters, the whole experience through that lens. And she was a young girl leaving her home, and then everything was kind of strange, so I had to kind of take the story in that way. Like, she was remembering it in her own way, so for me, it was really important in writing the book to not rely too much on, you know, just my mother or just individual stories. Like, I really spent so many hours, like, reading archives and letters and books and documents to try to get the whole picture, because I don't think any, you know, one person can really do that.
You said your mother came from a small village.
So that's a great question. So her village, again, if you try to imagine, like, how, you know, how far away, like, her village is in the south of India, and Mokama, where the book is set, is in the north of India. So, you know, it's like going from, like I did, you know, maybe even further, like, from going from Houston to New York, or from like southern Italy to northern Europe. I mean, you're really going to, it's part of the same country, but they speak a different language, like, the landscape is completely different, the traditions were completely different. But what was happening there, there were a few things going on at the time that sort of brought my mother from her village in Kerala to Bihar. So one was just, became part of like the Indian Nurses Association, just letting people know like we really need nurses. They were writing letters to anyone saying like we need nurses, we need nurses. They set up a nursing school and then we need students, you know, just trying to find whoever they could. And you know, that word went out, of course, this is all by letter at this point, maybe telegram. That word though, it reached the ears of young women like my mother who were looking for a way out, right? Like this was in the 50s in India, that you know, the country was so new. And I think these were young women who were starting to see, wait a second, like this, things are happening in this country, you know, like they would hear about maybe a neighbor or a relative who had been the first person to leave their village and go be educated and work somewhere else. So, you know, there's a certain kind of young woman, I think, who's just looking for that opportunity wherever it might be. And when they heard about this nursing school, that's all they needed, you know. It's like some of the like my mother's classmates, one of them, she had never even seen a train until she got on a train to like go 1,000 miles away to study nursing. So that's, you know, one of the things I wanted to capture in my book is that I think it really takes a certain kind of person to do that, and their spirit, like, I hope comes through the stories.
What did your mother do after she was educated? After she came to nurse, did she stay at that hospital?
Just for a couple of years. So they would train nurses, and they had to serve out, I think they called it like a bond, like a couple of years where they work at the hospital. But again, like these were young women who, once they had left their village, they were like, I'm not going back. Like that's, I'm done with that. Like I want to see the rest of the world. So my mother and most of her classmates, they were also so well trained. I mean, the education they got at Nazareth Hospital, the nursing school was so good. And again, India was a young and growing country at this time, and the cities were opening up hospitals. So they, my mother went to New Delhi, you know, one of the big cities. Other people went to Bombay or immediately went abroad. So she worked in New Delhi for a few years. And again, it was so unusual at the time. This was in the late 60s in India. She was a young single woman, and she just, you know, moved to the city. She lived in a nurse's dormitory with her friends, you know, many of her classmates from the nursing school at Mokama. And that's where she met my father. They didn't, you know, they didn't have an arranged marriage. You know, they just met, love at first sight, and they got married, and I was born, and a few years later they came to the United States. So again, it's like that sense of being independent and being able to just decide your whole future, I think it really started with the education that she got.
Because of your mom's experience, did she expect and encourage you to go off on your own adventure?
Well, yeah, it's not always that simple, I suppose. You know, I think there is an impulse also, you know, that when you've gone through something very a long and arduous journey, I think there's an impulse that parents want their children's lives to be much easier and more predictable. So I think there was a part of both my parents, you know, who sort of hoped that, like, well, we went through so much, you know, why don't you take it easy? Like, you should just, like, maybe do something predictable and, you know, stay close to home. Of course, I didn't do that either. Yeah, you know, there's something of my mother in me. I also, you know, went far from home, you know, have reported all over the world in some sketchy places, but, you know, that's kind of the story of parents and children, I think.
Did she continue to work as a nurse in the United States?
Oh, yeah, she did. She had a long career as a nurse, mostly at Methodist Hospital in Houston. She's retired now, but, yeah.
How did they end up in Houston?
So, again, you know, my mother's, really her lifelong friends are, you know, some of them who studied at Mokama with her, and I think, you know, when it was in the early two of them are also, they were also religious sisters, and they talked about how that period of World War II was just a period of such change, and they could somehow feel that like their sister, something had changed in her that she was sort of moved by all of that. Even Sister Anne Cornelius, who by personality I think was very different from everything I've read about her. She had, she was from a big family. She had one older sister who was like the one that everybody else looked up to in the family. And that sister had gone overseas, and it's like the thing that everyone else wanted to do, so sort of, that impulse, like I kept seeing versions of that in so many of their stories.
What along with that motivation do you think probably inspired you and the others to immigrate to the United States?
It's interesting. I think there is something about people who leave their homes, once you've done, I sometimes think that there are like two kinds of people. There are people who stay in their hometowns and kind of stay close to home. And then there are people who, for whatever reason, sometimes it's because of conflict, sometimes it's because of opportunity or just that feeling of like wanting to see the world outside. Once you've left your home, as my parents did, once they left the village and went to another city far away in India, I think that once you've done that one time, you're forever changed by that, and you're open to other opportunities that come along. So it's like the big change was just leaving the village and going to Mokama. So once she had done that, it's like, okay, should I go to a big city that I've never lived in and work as a nurse? Sure, why not? Oh, now I hear that nurses are going to the United States. Shall I do that? Sure, why not? Shall I leave New York and go to Texas? Why not? I think there's something about that once you, the difference between, as one writer put it, those who leave and those who stay, it's a really deep and profound thing.
Other questions?
Yes.
What's the hospital like today? Like, is the staff mostly Indian, Native Indian, or any Americans come over to?
So I was last there in 2018 as I was finishing up my research. I've been in touch a little bit since then. Obviously during the pandemic, it's been very difficult for them. One of the most interesting things about the way the sisters have run the hospital over the years is that they're incredibly open to change and have been willing to adapt over the years. So, and I think it's really the secret to the survival of their institution over all these years. They built that hospital after much struggle, but they were not tied to the idea of we built a hospital and so therefore it has to stay just as it is, because they started that hospital when there was nothing else there, like no other healthcare in that area. But over the years, they expanded that hospital, but then there were other hospitals nearby that were, they were doing sophisticated surgeries and all of that. So then they sort of reflected, what is their purpose? Are they meant to just run a hospital, or are they meant to serve their community? So that hospital has really kind of changed over time, depending on the needs of the community. So for example, in the 1980s, when HIV and AIDS had come to India, very few people were willing to treat those patients, they started doing that. Over time, they've devoted parts of the hospital to, more sort of social service work. They now run a hospice. It's mainly like a hospice and primary care facility. They do a lot of village-based work as opposed to sort of relying on the big hospital, because they can see that that's where
during COVID, although, you know, they were no longer really running a full service inpatient hospital, when the need was there, they made those beds available again. So I think the example for me from the hospital is not just, wow, amazing, they brought, you know, modern medicine to this place, but their thoughtfulness and being willing to adapt to what the community needed is really been inspiring to see.
So does your dad work in healthcare too? I'm just curious about that.
No, my dad, completely different. Like he had, he worked in like civil engineering when he was in India, and then but then had to do something completely different when he came to the U.S. So he worked in insurance and real estate for a long time. You know, again.
Did your mom end up teaching nursing at all here, or like?
No, she really liked working with patients.
Yeah,
yeah, she worked as a nurse, you know, in recovery rooms. They were generally like really appreciative, and I think they, you know, they knew some of the sisters who are in the book, and they know that, you know, they all have personalities, like, you know, sometimes difficult personalities. But I tried to sort of convey their stories in all of their complexity, and also, you know, there were definitely some moments that were difficult for the hospital, for the nursing school, the conflict between these American women and the young Indian women who were whom they were training. I mean, that was a very real thing, and again, a kind of challenge for both of these groups of women to adapt to each other. But it was just wonderful. I mean, of course, they asked me, you know, many excellent questions, but they were sort of open to every part of the story, which I really appreciated.
You were talking about that. The order and its mission just seems to have blossomed
mm-hmm.
with the influx of the Indian women.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to underestimate, I don't want to, you know, sort of, I think that the Sisters of Charity, you know, they're facing the same challenges that I think every religious community, you know, Catholic religious community is, which is, you know, most of their membership is getting much older, and there aren't as many younger women who are entering, again, religious life, because there are other opportunities, I think, open to them. I mean, there was a time when, you know, becoming a nun, of course, that people had a strong vocation, but it was also an opportunity to be educated, to, you know, to work and do interesting things in the world. But again, to your point, I think the reason why I think this order has survived and endured perhaps better than many others is that willingness to change. I mean, they have welcomed, you know, almost from the beginning, I sort of explained this in the book, they brought Indian women not only as members, but into the leadership of
you know, being willing to rethink, well, what does that mean and how should we as a community change and adapt to this new membership? And in fact, those changes are still happening because, you know, in the 50s and 60s, the first Indian women to enter the order and also to become nurses were from a particular community in South India who were, you know, generally well educated and you know, long tradition of being Catholics. Now, like, the Indian women who are coming in are increasingly from different communities. They're from much more marginalized communities, and that's been an interesting tension between, you know, different groups of Indian women, and again, like, they're being asked to sort of change and adapt to this new reality. So that process, I think, really, like, it doesn't end, I think, for this community or for any other.
Was there any conflict between the official Indian officials and the nuns that went over? I mean, you know, they're going into an entirely different country. Different ideas.
Oh yeah, I mean, this is something that it's kind of in the background of everything they're doing. You know, I mean, they were Americans coming to India, I think, with lots of good intentions, doing work that was absolutely needed in India at the time. But you know, India had just gotten rid of British rule, and so they were quite, I mean, not everyone, but like many people. Were quite suspicious of foreigners and not sure, like, do we want missionaries at all? Like, you know, what does this mean for us as an independent nation? Now, India itself, I think, has had to wrestle with that question because, you know, the fact is, India has never been just one community of people. It's a very large and diverse place. So I think India is sort of trying to figure out for itself what that means. But again, I think the sisters had to, that was one of the things that they had to negotiate. You know, they wanted to not just, you know, not just come and work for a few years, but like really build something lasting and meaningful. They had to understand how to work with not just the national government of India, but local people, you know, some of whom were very, very welcoming of the work that they were doing and needed the work that they were doing, and others who were kind of threatened by this. I mean, this was, again, it was just something that didn't fit into the existing social order. So anything that seems challenging, the people, you know, the men in charge, and they were, you know, almost entirely men, sometimes did not know what to make of this very, you know, somewhat, like really quite a powerful institution run entirely by women. I mean, like what does that mean in this place? And so that was something that they navigated quite skillfully, and they still do today, I'd say.
Could I thank you for writing this, because there's so many things about fabulous women who have gone places and accomplished things that nobody knows about.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really lovely that you took the time.
Oh, thank you. I really appreciate that comment. I mean, Diane knows, you know, when I started the research for this book, the president of the order, Susan Gatz, I had a, you know, took quite a lot of convincing for them to be willing to open up their archives. I mean, that was something that.
And may I say, she is a pres girl.
yes, right. That's right. Yes, of course. I'm not surprised for everything I've heard about her. But she, you know, I had a really good talk with her, and she said, you know, the reason why she decided to do that is that she understood that this story was significant not just to the order, but really to women's history. And women, for so long, like the things that they have done, the contributions that they've made to, you know, to Catholic history, to the history of Kentucky, to the history of India. If they don't talk about it, if they don't allow these records to be opened up and for people like me to write books about them, no one would ever know. So that was really important to me to create a record of it.
Thank you.
Thank you.